deck of the spire of the Chrysler Building. The famous deco designer Raymond Loewy on a locomotive that he designed for the Pennsylvania Railroad. Wonderful image from one of my favorite directors of the 1930s, Frank Capra, an image from Meet John Doe and the darkest of his movies, and a good example of how even the optimistic works of the Depression had this very dark coloring. And finally, the most famous image of the 1930s, Dorothea Lange's portrait of migrant mother, who was a pea picker in the Pomo, California. Dorothea Lange just happened to stumble on her one day, took 6 or 7 or 8 pictures. Now, she actually asked her to have, instead of having the children face the camera, she had two of her children actually face their mother and kind of nestle into her arms and shoulders. And the look of the image on her face, of both of weathered beaten and of determination at the same time, fear, worry, and anxiety, I mean, sums up many of the themes of Depression art and of Depression life and culture. And the most amazing thing about this, the most amazing thing about these photographs, or the Inspire films, or the music of Gershwin or Cole Porter, is we can understand, and I try to explain in my book, why it's great for its time, why it reflects its times. What is so astonishing is the degree to which it still resonates for our times as well. And I suppose you could say this is the additional bonus that we get about real works of art, that they not only reflect their moment, they not only emerge and comment on their moment, but that they stay current because they deal with fundamental human realities. And it would be hard to imagine, even in times of prosperity, it would be hard to ignore the fundamental human reality that you see in a photograph like this, or the fundamental elegance and beauty that you'd see in a Fred Astaire film, or the beautiful and well-earned optimism of a song like Pennies from Heaven. And so I think one of the great things about Depression art is not only was it great then, as people have rarely understood, but it's still great for us today. And anyway, I appreciate your attention. I'd be glad to answer any questions you may have, objections. Sir, yes?
Wait, I'm coming with a mic.
You talked a lot about music, movies, photography. Didn't really talk too much about painting, sculptures. Is there anything you can tell us about
I think it was parallel to literature in that a lot of painters turned towards realism, towards portrayal of the American scene. There was also a facet of this art that I didn't mention, which was that this was the period when a lot of artists turned inward to deal with the sources and the bases of American tradition, as if because the country was so under stress, because the country felt threatened, people look not only within themselves individually, but within the society for sources of inner strength, in this case, national strength. Now, this was especially true of the federally funded art programs that I talked about, like those funded by the Treasury Department, because they, by decorating public buildings, they had to be approved by the local authorities, and therefore, they often involve local stories, local traditions, or elements from American history or folklore. And this is probably one of the great trends or turns in American art, this naturalistic and American, native turn, regional art, for example. There were a number of abstract artists working in the 1930s. Some of them, like Stuart Davis, who had been abstract artists earlier and continued to be so during the Depression, even when they became political radicals. That's a very, very brief summary of some of the trends in the visual arts during the period. Samantha here knows much more about it than I do. Don't be shy.
What would you do wrong to lose it?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
What if you do wrong to lose all that goodness in it?
Well, the question is, what did we do wrong to lose all that? What happened was the war came. And the war, during the war, the solidarity that I talked about in terms of community became the war effort. And the war effort required people to be completely upbeat. And so you have photographers who, 2 or 3 years earlier, were making images of migrant workers and sharecroppers, suddenly celebrating America, a photographer like Margaret Burke White. A tremendous optimistic surge in terms of backing the war effort. And so what happened was the country changed, and changed again after the war when a certain level of prosperity arrived. And the Depression art suddenly seemed very old-fashioned. It doesn't seem old-fashioned today, but it seemed old-fashioned in the 1940s. Sir? I'm sorry.
Do you see evidence of these kinds of trends now in this recession, depression?
Well, you know, in the spring, right after the recession hit, I found, you know, suddenly CNN and CBS were beating their way to my door saying, what do you think the effect of the recession is going to be on the younger generation, or the effect of the recession on the arts? And I said, so I found myself making things up, because the arts takes usually a few years for artists to assimilate things, for things to kick in. And after about a half a dozen of these interviews, I realized that I was essentially, if you'll excuse the word, bullshitting. And I said, no more. I don't really know what the effect is going to be. But it'd be interesting to see so in the next few years.
Some people were concerned that you didn't mention Walt Disney or anything about Disney in your book.
Yeah, I don't know. I'll just have to watch a lot of Mickey Mouse cartoons for the next edition. The funny thing about that is, you know, I discovered very early on that my imagination takes off not by cataloging popular enthusiasms, but only in the presence of popular culture that, as I said at the end of my talk, somehow it turns magically into art. And I guess Disney never had that effect for me, even though I loved the cartoons as a kid. So maybe I'll just have, since so many people have said, what about Walt Disney? What about Mickey Mouse? I guess I'll have to go back and see if I can do something with Mickey Mouse in the next edition. My wife said to me the other day, I was going to go to a party, and I thought I was going to run into one of those reviewers that said, you left out Mickey Mouse. And she said, well, if you do that, what are you going to say to him? I said, I'm only going to say one thing. M-I-C-K-E-Y-M-O-U-S. Many years ago, I published a book on the 1960s. And as with this book, I was very selective. I wrote about things that really turned me on, and not about things that I had nothing to say about. And one of the reviews said, oh yeah, he deals with this so well, and this and that, and this and that. But there's something really important left out. That's Motown. Why doesn't he talk about Motown in this book? Believe me, if I had anything to say about Motown, I absolutely would have included it. So from then on, whenever I published a book and somebody said, oh, why didn't you talk about blah, blah, my wife would look at me and she said, there's Motown again.
So obviously, I want to thank Professor Dickstein so much for